It is a great honor and pleasure for me to introduce my friend Panos Pardalos. I met him for the first time about 20 years ago, thanks to my supervisor Antonino Maugeri. He is a distinguished professor of industrial and systems engineering at the University of Florida, Paul and Heidi Brown prominent professor of industrial and systems engineering, affiliated faculty member of the Computer and Information Science Department, director of the Center for Applied Optimization. Now I will show you just a short list of all his awards. He received a prize in 2017 from the University of Florida, from AIMBE in 2016, the Europe Fellow in 2015, from the Chinese Minister of Education in 2014. In 2013, the Euro Gold Medal, in another from China, and lots of other medals, one from Italy, from the University of Catania, where our collaboration started. This is a short list of some of his professional activities. He is editor-in-chief of many journals, such as Energy Systems, Computational Management Science, Springer Plus, Springer Open Journal, Global Optimization, Journal of Global Optimization, Optimization Letters, Cybernetics and System Analysis, and a lot of many others, Computational Optimization and Applications, Combinatorial Optimization, and so forth. Journal of Optimization Theory and Applications. Panos Pardalos is author of more than 20 books, 500 papers in refereed journals, 200 papers in refereed books and magazines, 150 books. He is author of more than 50 research papers in refereed conference proceedings, editor of about 30 special issues of journals. He has been invited speaker at more than 400 international conferences. His research interests are global and combinatorial optimization, network design problems, optimization in telecommunications, electronic commerce, data mining, biomedical applications, massive computing, and so forth. His HI index is 94. Well, today he will give a plenary lecture on the limits of computation in non-convex optimization. So, Panos, thank you.
Thank you, Daniela. Thanks for the invitation to this beautiful place here. I've been here maybe five times during the last 20 years. So I went to the United States in August 1977, so over more than 40 years ago, after I studied in Athens, mathematics and physics. And since that time, you know, thousands and thousands of papers have been published in optimization. So, and of course, in many other fields we are working in. So the question is always comes, do we really know a lot more things today than 40 years ago? And in fact, in the last, it has been some data, until 2013, the information collected since the beginning of civilization, say 5,000 years ago, was almost 5 exabytes of data. Today, every 5-10 minutes, we produce that information. So the question is, are we wiser? Do we learn more things, okay? And of course, the first, the big question is, what are the limits of our knowledge, okay? How much really we can learn, okay? It's a deep question, of course. Many questions are important to pose, even if we don't have answers, okay? And here we are going to focus on a little smaller problem. What are the limits of computation? Since we do optimization here, everybody computes something. And I have given this lecture a few times, and I have been enhanced with feedback I get from the people, okay? Everybody computes something. You go to a conference in engineering, and they claim, oh, we found the solution. Really? What do you, they compute something, okay? So it's a big question to to ask, okay, and to think about it. So, by the way, this talk is dedicated to my friend Chris Flouders, 2 years passed since his death. We did a lot of work together and we edited this encyclopedia of optimization, second edition that took quite a lot of time. We have to go back to the ancient Greeks, okay? Especially to philosopher, one of the pre-Socratic philosophers, Heraclitus, that starts asking the question, okay? What is the difference between knowledge and intelligence, okay? Because we have a lot of information, huge amounts of information, massive information today. Do we really have a lot of knowledge, okay? And I think Heraclitus, in a very provocative way, he made a lot of statements, okay? Really, do we know a lot of things, okay? And in fact, this motivated me, and I taught a class in the University of Florida on ignorance, because many times we focus on what we know, not what we don't know, okay? And somehow this is very controlled, okay, by the educational system, okay? Only to tell the people what we know, our students what we know and what we don't know. Why? And knowledge usually comes out of questions, so this type of questions, okay, of what we don't know. And we ask the questions, why, how much can we, what can we compute, and with what can we compute, okay? And we essentially we can formalize some concrete questions here, okay? What are the limits of what humans can compute? And of course, today we use machines, okay? And what are the limits of machines can compute? Are these limits the same? And what are the physical foundations and limitations of computation? These are very legitimate questions, okay? Very deep questions, okay? Maybe we don't give answers, but we must think about them, okay? And of course, there are many people, they attempted to understand these questions, okay? There are not a couple of papers. Since we have many students here, I will give you some basic references. There's a paper in Scientific American and one in Nature a couple of years ago, okay, that talk about these questions, okay? What are these limits, okay? And of course, I mentioned here machines. I didn't mention computers, okay? Digital computers. Because we can compute things with many types of machines. And I will mention a few. Analog computers, okay? Analog computers have been around for a long time, okay? They use the continuum phenomena in many natural situations, okay? And one of the first analog computers was the anti-Kithira mechanism. This was discovered about 100 years ago, has been reconstructed at MIT. It computes many things, okay? The positions of the stars in the sky and so on and so on. But recently, analog computers again came back in fashion. They have been used in many, of course, they've been used in airplanes, they've been used in many other things, you know, they check the temperature, the weight, the other things, you know, and so on, continuously. And of course, we are familiar with digital computers based on silicon technology, okay? And Turing and von Neumann developed the first models. Of course, Turing developed the idealized computer, okay? And later on, he implemented it, okay? And the question is, if a problem is difficult to solve with an electronic computer, is it difficult also with analog computers? There's a very deep theorem by Chert that says that an analog computer with finite resources can be simulated by a digital computer, okay? Very deep result, okay? So essentially, if a problem is, from the complexity point of view, whatever, it's difficult with a standard electronic computer, it's very difficult also with a digital computer. In fact, there's a very interesting paper here by a student of Stiglitz. Stiglitz had two very good Greek students, Verges and Papadimitriou. Unfortunately, the first author died in a car accident very young. But he put a very nice result. Using analog computers, computing local minima is intractable, okay, of optimization problems. And when this result was published, there was a lot of publicity in American scientists, the American Scientific American, in Nature, okay, about the consequences of this result. Very interesting result, okay. And in fact, Papadimitriou talks about Verges in his book, The Smile of Turing. I don't know if you know that book. And also we have biocomputers, okay? DNA-based computers today. This is not science fiction anymore. These are real computers, okay? And they are, in fact, they have the ability to self-replicate, okay? Self-assemble, you know? And they are very powerful, okay? In fact, 1994 was published the first paper in science solving a seven-city traveling salesman problem. You say, okay, that's a joke. But the idea was very powerful, okay? That you use DNA computers to solve the Hamiltonian cycle problem, okay? And since 94, we have a lot of progress now, okay? We have chips now based on DNA computer, okay? And we have now biochemical, bioelectronic, biological computers. And because of advances in nanotechnology, many combinations of this, we have different other type of machines than the digital computers we know. And people, they compute, okay, with these things. And there's a lot of activity in this type of research. In fact, the first conference of DNA was in, it was the IMAX conference at Princeton. 95, I was president of that conference. Since then, they have annual conferences, published a lot of books, and hundreds of scientists, they work on this type of problems, okay? So, DNA computing is not a science fiction. Maybe it's not familiar in this, in our profession, okay? But in many other professions now, they use biological computers, okay? They use for storage. DNA is a good means of storage. If you check Nature and Science all the time, you see several papers in this direction, okay? And what is the next revolution in computing? Maybe quantum computing, okay? Of course, there's a lot of dispute with exactly quantum computing. Because you know, for example, there are machines like the D-Wave, and in Canada, D-Wave sold a lot of computers in Microsoft, in Google, many also defense companies like Lockheed Martin, National Security Agency. Already they sold a lot of computers, and there's a lot also of antagonistic type of things between China, Russia, and the United States now. But quantum computing is completely different than the computing that we use today that is based on binary logic, okay? We have everything on bits, zero and one, okay? But is binary logic enough to solve many of the problems we have today, okay? In fact, the ancient Greek philosophers, they were intrigued by this question, okay? We know our logic. Binary logic has sentences that are neither true nor false, okay? I'm Greek, okay? If I make the statement, all Greeks are liars, is this true or false? Neither, okay? Later on, Kurt Gödel made it a theorem, then complete this theorem, okay? And we have, in every such systems, we have incompleteness, okay? So he formalized it, okay? And in fact, Democritus, Zeno, consider many of these things, they understood the inefficiency of our binary logic, okay? How many of you, they know the paradoxes of Zeno? Maybe you know one or two, but he wrote a book with 32 paradoxes, logical paradoxes, okay? Anyway, quantum computing has been, initiated with quantum mechanics in Russia by Riemann, later on in America by Feynman and many other people. But today, there is a lot of activity in quantum computing. In fact, a couple of years ago, I organized the first conference at the Fields Institute, Optimization and Quantum Computing, okay? Because Canada has a lot of activity, has the Perimeter Institute, and there's a lot of activity now around this the quantum computing. So, let's go back to optimization now. This is about the historical stuff and the computing. As I mentioned here, many times we go to many conferences of engineering and people, they present the results, and they say, we compute the solution. I'm really surprised. They have a model, very complicated model, highly nonlinear, many times non-convex, zero, one constraints, and they claim they solved it. They found the solution, okay? That's a big news, okay? And then you ask, how do you find the solution, okay? Let's ask the question here. What is global optimization? We can have many more versions of these questions, okay? The first is, do we really compute a globally optimal solution? If I'll tell you now that I solve a Hamiltonian cycle problem, okay, in a graph of 1 million knots, do you believe me? I can claim, I say, I solved a Hamiltonian cycle problem with 1 million knots. I have to provide the certificate of optimality to you. So when I make the claim that I solve globally a problem, okay, then I must provide the certificate of optimality. The second type of question, okay, do we compute good locally optimal solutions? I say good, okay? Or points that satisfy the optimality conditions, okay? Good means that I don't just use gradient descent, okay? Because we know if I follow the negative gradient, the function decreases, I find some lowest value, okay? Actually, many people, they do that, okay? Or the third question, do we compute better solutions than known solutions? And I think the majority of the people does the last one, okay? So you see what some other person did in a computational study. They solve the Steiner tree problem, okay? And they say, oh, on the same instances, I do something better, okay? Of course, this makes sense too, because many times in practice, we have, you know, we compute things. We have a solution, okay? We have some good solution, okay? We have a solution to a scheduling problem in a hospital. Hospitals are working, okay? You have some solution, can you do it better in time and whatever, okay? You have other types of problems. So in practice, we have solutions. Things are working, okay? So can we do better than what we have, okay? So all these three are valid, okay? And of course, there's a fourth one, I didn't put it here. Many times, a model, since humans, they make the models, are infeasible, okay? And then, in fact, Bixby was telling me that 20% of the problems he gets to solve with Siebel and Gurubi, okay, they are infeasible. And then the task is, how can you manage to make them feasible, okay? You can ask, you know, the question, what's the minimal data perturbation to make them feasible? Very valid question, okay? So this is a very important question to have. So all these questions we can investigate here and why they are difficult to solve, okay? So now, some of the things I will tell you, they are not new, but we must reflect always back, okay, and see what we have done over all these years, okay? So it gives us some ideas for future work, okay? But there are some cases, in fact, there's a beautiful paper here by Igiri, published in the Journal of Global Optimization, very beautiful paper. There are some cases where global solutions matter, okay? Only global solutions make sense. For example, if you have this problem, minimize the rank of a matrix over a set of matrices here. Every admissible point is optimal, so global only makes sense. Okay. And the second problem there, where you minimize the CX, the objective is the number of non-zero components in X, to minimize that. And this problem is very important now in data analysis. Okay. Many times you try to find the smallest, to minimize the features in a problem, okay, in a data analysis problem. Sparse feature selection is one of these problems here, okay? So, there are cases where this problem, just getting only the global solution makes sense, okay, not other things. Anyway, there are many references here, historical things I can give you if someone has an interest, especially for the students. And I will have a little history here. It's amazing that there is such a huge gap in optimization, okay? Maybe the first optimization problems were in the books by Euclid, okay? Very, today they look very elementary problems, the minimum distance of from a point to a plane, okay? We find it's a very small exercise for high school, okay? And then we have 1500 years darkness, okay? No optimization, okay? Nothing, what happened, okay? Only later on, we had Fermat, Hamilton, okay? Other people, and of course, maybe Carl Theodori, that implicitly in his books mentioned optimality conditions. And only in the 1950s, we have the famous optimality conditions for optimization. It took quite a long time, okay? This. Many people they know, the Kutakyr optimality conditions. Some people, they call it contact Caruso climatic conditions, a long time, okay, before that. And today we have a plethora of approaches, okay? And of course, people, they mention that, you know, we live in the world, okay? Nature is constantly optimizing, and we must try to mimic nature, okay? Is it true that nature always optimizes? Do you think we are optimal designs of nature? Maybe not, okay? Even our body here, the left, is not the same as the right part, okay? But of course, we get a lot of ideas from nature. And many times, in nature, is not only the importance of the final solution, the optimal solution, but the process, how do we get to a solution, okay? Take, for example, protein folding problems, okay? How do we go to the final stage of folding? And many times, also, practice is not the best solution, okay? The second best, we have a cost, okay? How to compute. Cost is associated. We go to a company, and the best solution costs $1 billion. And the second best that is closed and costs $10,000, why you should put the effort to find the best one, okay? So ranking of the solutions is very important many times. What's the best, the second best, the third best for decision makers, not just for the mathematical point of view, it's good to know what is the second best solution and the cost associated with it. What is the third best, the fourth best, and so on, okay? So these are fundamental types of ideas we get from nature, okay? Anyway, there are a beautiful book here I will suggest, Optimality Principles in Biology, a very beautiful book, small book. Unfortunately, it's difficult to find it. It's out of print, but it has many interesting cases that discusses these ideas, okay? But nature-motivated approaches are important, okay, but with some care. And since we have many young people here, I will also mention occasionally some open questions here. Still, the optimality conditions we have are very restrictive, okay? If this and this, then this. Okay? We have constrained qualification conditions, you remember, and how to check this is very difficult, okay? So finding general optimality conditions still remains an open problem. And the feasibility question that I mentioned to you is very difficult also, okay? And when we talk about large-scale problems, large-scale means sparsity, okay? But sparsity is not involved in these optimality conditions, okay? So this is a very good, maybe, idea to think why. How can we explain that large-scale problems that are sparse can be easily solved, okay? Big size, but sparse, okay? How the sparsity is involved. And sometimes the sparsity is random, sometimes has very canonical forms, and so on and so on. But now I go to the issues, okay, that relates now to the limits of computation, okay? That non-convex problems are very difficult, okay? People, they acknowledge they're very difficult in general. And we'll see why they are difficult, okay? We go from the simplest questions, okay? Remember, we say that many people, when they devise an algorithm, what they do is they try to compute a point that satisfies the optimality conditions. So the simplest question is, if I have a problem, how easy is to check that has a point that satisfies the optimality conditions? Before looking for it, I must see how difficult it is to check it, okay? And if you take this simple, innocent problem here, optimizing a quadratic function, okay? Q is symmetric, not any type of, it has negative and positive eigenvalues. Over the first order, okay? And you ask the question, does it have a point that satisfies the optimality conditions? What's the complexity of this problem, okay? And if you take the optimality conditions of this problem, it's nothing else but a linear complementarity problem, okay? In fact, this is the simplest variation inequality problem, okay? It talks about existence of solution. It's a symmetric linear complementarity problem. And you guess that the answer to this problem is that it is an NP-hard problem, it's an intractable problem, okay? Nobody can check that in the worst case in polynomial time. And I have the proof of this because it's so trivial, okay, of course. To discover a proof is much different, much more difficult than to check it, okay? So if you see it, okay, so Everybody knows the simple knapsack problem, okay? If I have A's, and I have the B, and I want to find the subset of A's with sum equal to B, okay? And everybody knows that this problem is intractable, but nobody knows a better way than enumeration, okay? The worst case, 2 to the n, okay? Steps to solve this problem in finite time, of course. Now, for this data, I can construct the matrices A and B. Sorry, the matrix Q and the vector C here, okay? So I have a complementarity problem, and if I solve the knapsack problem, I solve the complementarity problem. And if I solve the complementarity problem, I solve the knapsack problem. It's a very beautiful, so simple construction, okay, that tells me, even checking if an optimization problem so simple has a point that satisfies the optimality conditions is an intractable problem. This is an amazing result. So we must be very careful with the statement we make, okay? The simplest variation inequality problem, okay? And of course, then you go to the next level and you ask the question, people, they compute better, good local solutions, okay? But how easy is to compute local solutions in non-convex optimization problems, okay? I will tell you in a second here. In fact, there's the famous satisfiability problem that we use in computer science, okay? It's a discrete problem. You have a formula here, a sentence in conjunctive normal form. You have Boolean variables that they take the value true or false, 0 or 1, 0, okay? And you can ask the question, is there an assignment of the Boolean variables that make this sentence true? And of course, this problem can be solved in exponential time, in finite exponential, 2 to the n steps, okay? If I have n Boolean variables. But we know it's the first complete problem by Steve Cook, okay? In fact, this problem can be used as a global optimization problem, okay? Connects easily the discrete and continuous world. I can move from the Boolean space to the Euclidean space. In fact, I use this as an exercise in my book, Introduction to Global Optimization. As an exercise, okay? But it's a very powerful exercise, okay? So, if you have a satisfiability problem, you can formulate as a continuous optimization problem, okay, in the Euclidean space, by different ways. For example, for each clause, you can define these functions here, okay, and you can prove that if the solution to this problem is equal to zero, the formula is satisfiable, okay, or you can use differentiable objective functions. For example, you can consider p equal 2 here, p equal 1, okay, so b quadratic. But again, you can show one-to-one correspondence between the solution to the problem in the Euclidean space and the problem in the discrete space, okay? This is a very important observation here. And of course, people, they established many other types of results of this nature, for maximum clique, for chromatic number, and so on and so on. So, discreteness is the simplest case of non-convexity, okay? Since discrete and continuous. Historically, they differentiate these problems for some bad reason, but I think we should differentiate between convex and non-convex. And I make this statement all the time, okay? The non-convexity relates to the difficult problems, the convex to the easy problems. In fact, this satisfiability is a model to check phase transition, okay? Still, it's a question. Why some problems are easy and some problems are difficult? What is between them? Is this from easy to difficult a discontinuous phenomenon or a continuous phenomenon? How do we go from easy to difficult? For example, for satisfiability, they have done a lot of studies and they found some phase transition parameter, this ratio of the clauses over the number of variables, okay? But they have been done the same things for other types of problems, okay? In fact, there are two groups of people, one in Microsoft who works on information-based techniques to understand this phase transition, and the group in Russia, they based on hierarchical optimization, the degree of the difficulty increases, okay, from easy to hard. But still, there remains an open question. I have some references here that some people may be interested. In fact, I wrote a paper recently, a survey paper, it's not here, about the hierarchical approach to phase transition problems. because many classes of problems don't have been understood somehow. How do we move from easy to difficult, okay? But there are still fundamental questions, okay? Phase transitions in continuous optimization. Most of this can be done in discrete problems, okay? And what is the boundary between polynomial sovereign and NP-hard problems in global optimization, in non-convex optimization? We know that non-convex optimization problems that still can be polynomial sovereign, okay? Non-convexity is not the only reason that something is difficult, okay? We don't know exactly. It's a question, okay? Is the number of multiple local minima? Is the shape of the objective function? Is the distribution of the local minima? Is what? What makes this problem? It's a big question that still remains open, okay? So from this problem here, we can construct a lot of simple instances from satisfiability of quadratic problems, very innocent looking, okay, that are extremely difficult to compute locally optimal solutions. For example, this quadratic problem at the bottom there, okay, has only zeros and ones, okay? But just to make the story short, we can prove that the satisfiability formula is satisfiable if and only if this point for this objective function is not a strict minimum, okay? Or it's not a local minimum and so on. Why I care about strict local minimality? Because many times in the classical book in optimization, you see that if this and this and this, and if the function is locally strictly convex, then this result. How do you check if a function is locally strictly convex? It's a very nice mathematical result, but how do you check if it's locally strictly convex? It's intractable, okay? It's an intractable problem. And many other type of interesting results from this type of problems. Of course, people, they try to cope with these issues, considering average case complexity. But even for LP, for linear programs, this question has been not answered, okay? Because average case for large scale problems means sparse, but sparsity, for sparse problems, we don't have a probability distribution. So even for linear programs, although we know the average number of pivots, if the distribution is this and this, is polynomially bounded, in the general large-scale instances, we don't know, okay? And of course, then we have parametric complexity, that the results depend on the size of the solution. And again, for large problems, sparsity is not a component of the complexity that we know so far. Why we ignore sparsity? Sparsity must be part of the complexity analysis of problems, okay? Because for large scale problems today, we have huge problems. We solve problems today with millions of variables, okay? Sparsity must be part of the complexity, and it is not. So it's an open problem, okay? Anyway, there are some problems here. But now we go to the top level of this difficulty, okay? What can we compute, we say, okay? And of course, we know convexity is important. Optimization, it's good to know the function is convex, okay? And it's the same, you know, in number theory, we know that prime numbers are very important, okay? We have the prime number theorem, every number is the unique product of primes, but still we cannot compute primes. We know primes up to a certain, you know, size, you know? We have no fast algorithms to compute primes, okay? We don't even know the distribution of primes in the numbers, okay, the integers, okay? Because you can find gaps as big as you want without any number to be prime, okay? So the issue becomes, what do we know about the complexity of checking convexity of a function of a set, okay? It's the same thing. If I know to check the complexity of a function, I know how to check the complexity of a set because I can consider the epigraph, you know, or the index function, okay? And in 92, I did a special issue of math programming with Babasi. We had a list of several open problems in optimization, and one was, how easy is to check, to answer this question in polynomials, okay, in the space of polynomials? Is it easy to check if a multivariant polynomial is convex or not? It'd be nice to have a box here, function in, and say, convex, non-convex. Unfortunately, that doesn't exist. Even for 4-degree polynomials, okay, the results are very disappointing. So we should not expect so much. Okay? We have limits in what we can do, okay? And what we can compute. In fact, this answer was given a few years ago by a group of people in MIT. They proved that it's NP-hard to check convexity of a polynomial of any fixed even degree more than 4. An amazing result, okay? In fact, they proved about strict, strong convexity, strict convexity, the same things, okay? And so on and so on. And this is the paper that appeared in Math Programming, okay? From 92, was open the problem until 2013, okay? It was published, this result. And of course, we know we have extensions of some convexity to quasi-convexity and pseudo-convexity and so on, but our local solutions are global, okay? And still, the results are negative there. So maybe our lack of understanding convexity, okay? Of course, convexity is defined in many ways, okay? How do you define a function is convex, okay? Doesn't matter, okay? So our lack of understanding if a function is convex, maybe this is the source of all these difficulties to compute, to find points that satisfy the optimality conditions, to compute or recognize local solutions, and of course to recognize global solutions. So these are the difficulties. Made. And I have some very interesting questions here. This was done for polynomials. What about general functions? I believe that the problem is undecidable. Okay? You know, we have many undecidable problems. After the Hilbert strength problem, okay, people they prove a plethora of problems that are undecidable. We don't even know if there's an algorithm for the solution, okay? And this remains an open problem. But of course, convexity is very important in optimization because we have the fundamental result that almost every function is a difference of two convex functions, DC optimization, okay? So it's good to know about these issues, okay, about convexity. And a good question is how can you have a best decomposition of a function DC? What does it mean best? If you have a quadratic function, I know what is best. The negative eigenvalues and the positive eigenvalues define the two functions, okay? But if the function is not with a fixed Hessian, what does it mean best? I think this is a question we must ask, okay? There are some attempts. In fact, Huang Tui has some kind of results that you mean by best. Okay? The practical issue is, if I have an objective function, how can I isolate the non-convexities of this function? Then I deal only with a non-convex part. How can I isolate the non-convexities? Because difference of two convex functions means convex plus concave. So the concave part is the hard part of the objective function. How easy is to do it? And this remains a very difficult question. But of course, we have a lot of algorithms to solve these problems, okay? In the last years, I've been involved in many problems in many fields, from biomedical engineering to supply chain, and recently smart manufacturing and marketing and many things, okay? We have exact algorithms, okay, for small-scale problems because of limited use, okay? However, it's important to have exact algorithms for this type of problems, okay? Because you must see the limitations of the exact algorithms. Okay? And sometimes exact algorithms can solve large problems in some cases, okay? Of course, people, they try to attempt to have approximate algorithms where they guarantee how far you are from the optimal solution, but many of these problems are also intractable to solve, okay? Like, for example, maximum click problem was the first result, okay? So we have to go to heuristics, okay? People today, they use a lot of heuristics, okay? And if you go to many of the talks in this conference here, especially if you go to any conference in engineering, heuristics. If you go to any aerospace conference, genetic algorithms, biologically inspired algorithms, all these type of algorithms, okay? Heuristics, okay? That's what the people they use, okay? So what are the heuristics, okay? Well, Archimedes lived close by here in Syracuse. How far is Syracuse from here? He was a very famous Greek mathematician, okay? You know this picture here when he was taking a bath and he was always thinking of questions, okay? He thought, how can I measure the volume of any solid, convex or non-convex, okay? And he realized that you put it in a bath full of water and you measure the water that comes out, it's easy to measure the volume, you know. And he jumped out and said, I found it, Eureka. This is the first, the etymology of the word heuristics, okay? Means techniques that find solutions, okay? And if I end Wilf's terminology, for reasons we don't understand why. Heuristics are techniques that find solutions for reasons we don't understand why, okay? But they compute. They compute solutions, okay? And of course, Archimedes did many more things than computing the volume of a solid. Do you know his picture in which that I have there before it appears? You have any mathematicians here? They said, no, this is the Fields Medal, okay? The Fields Medal has Archimedes' face. So apparently he did many more things, okay? In fact, a couple of years ago, was published a book with the title The Modern Works of Archimedes. So the message is we must go back and read these original people, okay? From the pre-Socratics to the Archimedes mathematical ideas. So heuristics are around here, okay? I will illustrate this with an idea now here, because the key question now is here, how good are these heuristics, okay? We compute something, what do we know of the quality of the solution, okay? This is a big question. So I have a simple problem here. Minimize this function here of the domain S, bounded, okay? And I consider this function is a concave function, okay? So everybody knows the classical Frank-Wolf algorithm. It appears in many books, okay? Frank-Wolf algorithm. How many people they know Frank? Many people, maybe they know Wolf, but not Frank. Frank is a lady, Margaret Frank. How many of you they knew that it was? So behind the theorems is good. I tell the young people to know the people, you know? To know the people, you know? Sometimes students, they take a class, they use a textbook and ask them, who is the author of the textbook? I don't know. It's very strange, okay? So when you see a theorem, Frank Wolf, it's good to check who is Frank and who is Wolf, okay? Anyway. This algorithm is very simple. Suppose I start from many different points. I make it simple, concave here, so I don't have any line search. I solve LPs in the direction of the gradient, okay? Cost that are the cost of the direction of the gradient, and I repeat this, and after some time, we have a proof that this converges, okay? So, from different points, I start the Frank-Wolf algorithm. I get many local minima, and I get the smallest one with the smallest maximum value as my approximation to the global solution. It's a very nice heuristic. It's used many times, okay, by many people, okay? So how good is this? How good is this? Well, the techniques can show the following thing here. If I take, say, f of v is the smallest function value among all these local minima, okay? I take the spheres with centers, the local minima, and radius that depends on this difference divided by the Lipschitz constant. If the union of these spheres covers the domain, I'm done. This is a globally optimal solution. The proof is so simple that I include it here, okay? A two lines proof, okay? These are space covering techniques initiated by Yuri Evtushenko many years ago. They have been really refined in the last few years with a very good software for this type of problems. In fact, the union of spheres in this case must cover the vertices of the domain because the concave functions have global minima at the extreme points, okay? At extreme points. And if not, what do you do? Well, you make the spheres a little bigger by epsilon over L, the radius, okay? And if the new spheres cover the domain, then I'm within epsilon of the global minimum. This is a very beautiful result, okay? Because, of course, many times it's not easy to check covering of spheres of a domain. Okay, many times, of course, if it's a box, it's an ellipsoid, it's much easier, okay? But it gives you many ideas also about the difficulty of many classes of problems, okay? And If I know the Lipschitz constant of the function, okay, if the Lipschitz constant is very large, the spheres have a very small radius, okay? Difficult to do anything. But if the Lipschitz constant is small, these are easy problems from the computational point of view, okay? So I have to know, I must have some information, okay, for this type of problems, okay? And then the next class is the black box optimization. I don't know what's in my time. Yeah. Give some time, So minimize a function over a box. You don't know the function, okay, very well, but you compute the function at certain points. And there are many heuristics of this type. I won't go into the details of this. GRASP is one that I worked for many years. Stands for Greedy Randomized Adaptive Search Procedure. It was initiated by Mauricio Rizet, and now he is in Amazon. But we did together, we solved many problems of network design, practical problems in AT&T for the last 25 years. And GRASP has been extended from discrete to continuous optimization, okay? But this relates to the key question in machine learning, okay? What is machine learning? I have a function. I can compute it. I don't know the function. I can compute it in a certain number of endpoints, okay? And then ask the question, if you give me a point, what is f of x n, okay? What's the next point? And my answer is, I know nothing about it, okay? There are many theorems, I call the non-freelance theorems, okay? You must know something about the function, okay? If you don't know anything, you cannot tell anything. But if you know the function is polynomial, I can say something. If I know the function is Lipschitz, I can say something. If I know the function is exponential, I can say something, okay? Without some knowledge, okay? And this becomes an important problem in machine learning, okay? Data analysis, okay? I must know something in order to make a prediction of the next value of the function, okay? There's a very nice paper published in American, in the Notice of American Math Society, okay? But recently I have a survey paper, if someone has an interest, on freelance theorems in optimization, okay? No freelance theorems, okay? There's no freelance, okay? I must know something, okay? But how much I should know in order to make a good prediction, it's an open question, okay? In fact, Steve Smale works on this question for the last 20 years. On this type of question, okay? How can I bound, the prediction from the true value of the function if I know something about the function? It's a very fundamental question, okay? Anyway, in practice, we solve these problems, okay? So there are plenty of software, commercial and non-commercial, okay? For non-convex optimization problems. Some of the big classes are mixed integer linear optimization problems. We have excellent packages, commercial packages for this type of problem, like Siblex, Columbia, others, and so on and so on. So if you have a nice problem and you formulate it as a mixed linear 0, 1, you have a good chance you can solve problems up to high dimension, okay? In fact, these problems are very good also for functions that are separable. Functions that can be transformed to the sum of functions of one variable. For example, quadratic programming is separable, okay? I can do this using the eigenspectrum of the function or linear transformations, okay? And the first commercial package on global optimization, Psyconic, by Beal, is selling, okay? It's active. It sells this type of approach, okay? Because easily you can approximate separate optimization problems with piecewise linear functions. But piecewise linear functions can be converted equivalently to mixed linear 0-1. So the approximation problem can be solved exactly by 0-1, okay? So these are very successful types of software. The next is mixed nonlinear, but you know, this is, you cannot kill all the rabbits with one shot, okay? I mean, every problem can become linear, mixed, nonlinear, 0-1, okay? But sometimes, you know, it's good to have exact algorithms. Sometimes you are lucky because of special, taking advantage of the special structure of the problem, and you can solve this problem. But there are a lot of packages now, commercial packages, that they formalized in this type of way. So people, they reduce their problems to mixed linear 0-1 or mixed nonlinear 0-1. And of course, we have many specialized problems, okay, in many types of many specialized algorithms, okay, that are very efficient today in some problems, and many heuristics, excellent packages on genetic algorithms, molecular annealing, and so on and so on, okay? Even conferences specialized to all these classes of heuristics. If someone has an interest, I have a book published many years ago, 2002, on describes many of these type of approaches. But just this year, we published a several volume headbook, just came out in Springer, a headbook of heuristics that describes the state of the art from the people that that are the inventors of most of these heuristics, okay? If someone has an interest. Anyway, there are many challenging problems here, how to evaluate the heuristics, okay? Many people, they say through experimentation, beat it to death, okay? David Johnson used to say, beat it to death, okay? First, the exact solver, and then the heuristic, to see how much. In what classes is good, in what classes is bad, okay? Cannot be good in everything, okay? Of course, many heuristics have a lot of parameters that have to be set, and there are no ways to have automatic parameter identification. Upper and lower bounds are very important because approximate the optimality conditions, okay? Upper and lower bounds are approximations to optimality conditions, but many times computing good bounds is as difficult as computing the optimal solution, okay? And we need test problems that we know the solution, okay? Many people, they ignore this problem because it's like of an inverse type of thing. Construct difficult cases that you know the solution and you hide them, okay? And of course, these cases can be specialized for different type of algorithms, okay? And we need smart techniques like space covering techniques I mentioned before. We don't have many. We don't have many smart ways to see how good is the solution we get from a heuristic problem, okay? 99% of the people, they compare their solution with the previous techniques, okay? And they say, oh, we are doing better, okay? And they are satisfied. But we have no, we did not develop good ways. So we are limited to our knowledge on how to evaluate the heuristics, okay? So there are many questions here. Of course, I did not touch the multi-objective optimization. Only I discussed about one objective, okay? Problems become much more difficult in multi-objective optimization, and recently I published a book with Zelinskas on, is a monograph on non-convex multi-objective optimization where we address many of these type of problems. I won't go to this topic here. I think I'll stop here and it's time, I think, and I entertain any questions. Thank you very much for your attention.